great pleasure and privilege to present Martina Arroyo. Called by the New York Times at the height of her career as one of the most gorgeous voices before the public today, Martina Arroyo has had one of the most distinguished operatic and concert careers of any American soprano. Known particularly for her portrayals of Verdi and Puccini heroines, Ms. Arroyo grew up in Harlem, New York City. After gaining a BA in Romance Languages, she was persuaded to take singing more seriously, as she considered it more of a hobby, a lark. In order to study singing more intensely, she gave up her job as a teacher and became a social worker. In spite of the time she devoted to her vocal studies, she was still able to work over 100 welfare cases in 2 years. Her Metropolitan Opera debut was as the Celestial Voice in Don Carlos, after which she began her international career in Zurich and other European houses. She stepped in as Aida at the Met for an ailing Birgit Nilsson and was immediately offered a principal contract. During the 1960s and 70s, she was one of the Met's favourite singers, also singing in houses across the world, including Covent Garden, La Scala, Paris Opera, and the Teatro Colón in Buenos Aires. She was a frequent guest on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson, who loved her personality and storytelling skills. She was also invited by Tony Randall to appear in an episode of The Odd Couple. Ms. Arroyo is equally renowned as a teacher and mentor. The Martina Arroyo Foundation allows young singers to receive the best training and coaching of a complete role, and works with singers from all over the world. She has received numerous awards, including the 2010 Opera Honors Award from the National Endowment for the Arts and the 2013 Kennedy Center Honors. Martina Arroyo holds an exclusive place in the operatic world for her exquisite voice, nuanced characterization, her teaching, and also for her sharp wit and sense of humor. And having met Ms. Arroyo today, I can definitely attest to that. Mr. President, it is my great honor and pleasure to present Martina Arroyo for the honorary degree, Doctor of Music.
She is indeed one of opera's most effective public ambassadors.
Trans-idiomatic to describe an American experimental musical body of work that counts among its influences the work of Hildegard von Bingen, Warren Marsh, Paul Desmond, Karlheinz Stockhausen, Johnny Mathis, John Philip Sousa, John Cage, Ornette Coleman, Charles Ives, John Coltrane, Edgar Varèse, and Harry Parch. Anthony Braxton prefers, of course, to call his music now tri-centric or tri-axiomatic music, a holistic approach to composition where philosophical systems, musical systems, and ritual and ceremonial systems are fully integrated and interdependent. However one might choose to describe it, his music constantly places its highest value on emotional content and a sonic palette that never fails to surprise. And whatever terminology one uses, Anthony Braxton is indisputably one of the greatest musical thinkers and creative forces of our time. Mr. President, I am honored and delighted to present to you Anthony Braxton to receive the honorary degree, Doctor of Music.
Equally comfortable at the piano or at the podium, whether it be leading a small ensemble or an evening-length contemporary opera. I fondly remember studies with Mack in the 1970s, where he taught the greatest repertoire of the 20th century. I'll never forget his classes on Arnold Schoenberg's magnum opus, Pierre Lumiere, during which he led us through a deeply probing study of this great work, from a theoretical, compositional, historical, and performance perspective. As a final exam, each of us had to conduct several movements from memory under his watchful eye. While writing this note, I actually felt a bit nervous recalling my turn in front of the class. But Mack was a gentle teacher, demanding, but always encouraging. I was not alone in the benefit of his critiques. He taught many young composers who later developed into major forces in the field. Perhaps best known among them are the late Mihaila, who achieved great acclaim, including winning the Rome Prize, before returning to NEC to chair the composition department for a decade. And our own Hankus Netzky, musical polymath and chair of the contemporary improvisation department. Those of us who have had the pleasure of studying with Mack and witnessing his extraordinary works owe a great deal of debt to him for helping us build an unshakable foundation under his sage guidance. Mr. President, it is my privilege to present Malcolm Payton for the honorary degree, Doctor of Music.
Bernie Worrell, NEC class of 1967, started his musical life as a classical piano prodigy, playing with the Washington Symphony Orchestra at the age of 10. His documented NEC performances include Beethoven's Waldstein. But Bernie Worrell's career path led him far from Beethoven, most renowned as a master of analog synthesizers, particularly in the Mini-Book. Worrell spent many years with the legendary Carmen Fominelli organization. He played on, co-wrote, co-produced, and arranged some of that group's greatest songs, including the immortal Flash Hour, which features an unforgettable Mini-Book bass line. Can I do it? Dun 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 dun. albums and has contributed to recordings of dozens of other artists and bands. He is considered to be one of the most sampled musicians of all time. Combining funk, rock, classical, jazz, gospel, and Latin influences, Ernie Worrell has been and continues to be, ahead of his time, an exemplary global musician who combines styles and influences into unique and personal voice. In his words, all the woo in the world. Mr. President, I am honored and delighted to present to you Ernie Worrell to receive the honorary degree of Doctor of Music.
New York's downtown scene, and the jazz world.